Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And we've received apologies from Pam Gosol, and Mark Griffin will be joining us online. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Our members agreed. Great, we're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete, otherwise known as RAC, from two panels, with our first panel taking place in a round table format. And we're joined on our first panel in the room by David Baird, who's Property Service Manager at West Lothian Council, Peter Drummond, who's the Chair of Practice Committee at the Royal Incorporation of Architects in Scotland, Paul Jones, who's the Strategic Asset Manager at Edinburgh City Council, Ilse McFarlane, who's the Director at Built Environment Forum Scotland, Ian Morris, who's the Acting Director of Asset Management at the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and Peter Watton, who's the Service Director at City of Edinburgh Council and representing Solus. And we are joined online by Stephen Booth, who's Chief Officer of Corporate Landlord at Edinburgh City Council, Aberdeen City Council, Professor Chris Goodyear from the Senior Leadership Team at the School of Architecture at Loughborough University, Martin Little, who's the Chair of the Study Group at the Institution of Structural Engineers, Paul Livesey, who's the Scheme Manager of Collaborative Reporting for Safer Structures UK, otherwise known as Cross UK, and Sam Piplica, who's a senior specialist in building at the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors, otherwise known as RICS. And I welcome all of our witnesses to the meeting. And I'm going to begin our conversation this morning by inviting everyone to very briefly introduce yourselves. And I'll begin. I'm Ariane Burgess, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
I'm Lily Coffey for the constituency of Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
Hi, I'm David Baird. I'm the Property Services Manager for West Lothian Council.
Marie McNair, MSP, representing Clybank and Mulgaia constituency.
Good morning, I'm Paul Jones. I'm Strategic Asset Improvement Manager at Edinburgh Council.
I'm Service Director for Sustainable Development at St Edinburgh Council, and I'm here on behalf of Solus.
Good morning, I'm Miles Briggs, Conservative MSP for Lothian Region.
Good morning, everybody. Ilse McFarlane, Director of BEFS, Built Environment Forum Scotland.
Good morning. Ian Morris, Acting Director of Asset Management for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service.
Good morning again, everybody. I'm Peter Drummond, a practising architect, and I'm representing the Royal Incorporation of Architects.
Ivan McKee, SNP MSP for Glasgow Proven.
OK, and can we go online? Yes. Call you up there. So, Stephen, if you can come in.
Good morning. I'm Stephen Booth. I'm Chief Officer Corporate Landlord at Aberdeen City Council.
Thanks very much. And Professor Chris Goodyear.
Good morning. I'm Professor of Construction Engineering Materials at Loughborough University, and I've been leading research into RAC for the last two years.
Okay. And Martin Little.
Hi, I'm Martin Little. I'm a regional director at SWECO, and I'm here because I'm chair of the RAC study group of the Institution of Structural Engineers.
Okay. And Paul Livesey?
Good morning. My name is Paul Livesey. I'm a chartered structural engineer. I'm the manager of Collaborative Reporting for Safer Structures UK. Cross issued the industry-wide safety alert on RAC panels in 2019.
And Sam Piplica.
Hello, I'm Sam Piplica. I'm a chartered building surveyor by trade, and now I'm at RICS looking after the professional practice, so developing guidance and standards for our chartered building surveyors out there practicing.
Great, thanks very much for that. And so we're going to turn to questions from members, and what usually happens is a member will direct their question initially to somebody in the room or online, and if you want to come in to respond to that question as well, or to something someone else has said, if you can just indicate that to me in the room. If you are online, you can do that by typing an R in the chat function. And just to let you also know that there's no need for you to manually turn your microphones on and off, both in and in the room and online. We'll do that for you automatically. The intention of this panel, this roundtable, is that it should be a free-flowing conversation rather than a question and answer session. I do want to make sure that we, where appropriate, so you don't, I would say there's quite a lot of us, so don't feel that you have to respond to every single question, but come in and add to points as and when you feel it's important that something hasn't been brought to light. So with that, I'm going to begin. And I'm going to ask a fairly general question, and actually maybe I will direct it to Chris Goodyear to start the conversation. So given that the concerns about RAC's limited lifespan and potential for catastrophic failure have been known about since the mid-1980s, why do you think it's taken until now for significant action to be taken, or has remedial action been ongoing away from the media spotlight?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So first of all, the limited lifespan is a bit of an urban myth. Out in the media, it says 30 years lifespan, and it's given the impression that year 31, these things fall down. This is unsubstantiated in any decent reference or evidence or testing or what have you. But it is out there, and it is a belief. There are, you know, a lot of planks out there, 40 years old, 50 years old, and the ones we tested and investigated, most of them are performing very well. So just to get out there, the majority of RAC planks out there, even after 50 years, are performing extremely well and are very safe and will last another few decades. But coming back to the question, in the 80s, some testing was done by BRE, which showed that these planks probably a little less robust than traditional reinforced concrete, and they can deflect more or creep over time more than traditional reinforced concrete. So they weren't banned in the country, but BRE sent out this warning, as we do, take care with these things. You know, they do perform differently to traditional reinforced concrete. So the kind of guidance was perhaps there might be better ways of building out there. So the industry stopped using them in the 80s. But other countries carried on. And so there's countries like Germany who have been using them since the 50s, 60s and haven't stopped. So we gave out this, I'd call it a gentle warning rather than a hard, fast stop. So the industry stopped using it, but other countries didn't.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Does anyone else want to come in on that question? Or did we get that covered? Looks like... Oh. Peter.
I hesitate to clarify that answer, but whilst the 1986 BRE paper, Chris, did indeed come back with relatively relaxed results, is it not the case that the 2002 BRE paper does highlight the potential for problems in a minority of slabs as a combination of both construction quality and, in some isolated cases, original component quality?
Chris?
Yeah, so yes, I'd agree with that. But I'd also come back with every building that's 30, 40, 50 years is showing wear signs of wear and tear and should be surveyed and looked after appropriately. Whatever material old buildings are made of, they need surveying and looking after, and they perform maybe slightly differently than when they're originally designed. So again, the industry looked at this and thought, yeah, it's 30 years old back then, we'll keep an eye on it. And that's what some asset owners have been doing, particularly the NHS, that are probably the leaders in this field. They have a lot of RAC. And so they looked at this and said, well, we've got 10,000 planks in some hospitals. We're going to monitor these and keep an eye on them. And that's what they've been successfully doing.
Thanks. And I see Martin Little, you would like to come in.
Yeah, thank you. So to pick up on the subject of what's been going on, so the SCOS report was issued in 2009 following a failure of a panel in a school. that sort of raised the general awareness. It was something which I got to hear about as well. And so we had been doing some work largely at a couple of hospitals with the BRE from about 2009. So for about 10 years, we'd been doing low-level, slow research, but just generally doing a little bit more research into RAC, and not research, sorry, studying into the RAC at these two particular hospitals. So when the SCOS report was issued in 2009, the Institution of Structural Engineers put together a study panel, and that's the panel that I've been chairing from 2009. The NHS in England picked up the baton very strongly, largely because they've got quite a lot of hospitals entirely built of RAC. And there was quite a lot of investigations and research that was done on the back of that. And that led to the instigation of the major research project by Loughborough University that's now been going on for 2 to 3 years. And in the intervening period, the Institution of Structural Engineers and the panel I lead issued two updates. One was issued at the beginning of last year, which was issued just to raise awareness to the engineering profession of some of the findings that were coming to light from the investigations into the hospitals which were being looked at. And then we issued a second paper in April this year. And that paper was very much intended to spread the ability for engineers to assess the condition of RAC to beyond just a fairly small pool of people who'd actually just had hands-on experience of RAC. So the processes that have been set out to identify the hazards around RAC and the risks have been tended that any competent, and I use that word advisedly, but any competent engineer can pick up a situation with RAC and can assess it and can identify, come up with a RAG-rated classification of RAC that hopefully is going to have some form of uniformity across the whole of the country.
Thanks very much for that. And Paul Livesey, you wanted to come in as well.
Thank you. Just to go back to the BRE report from 1996, although they suggested that the planks that they tested were safe, they did suggest that RAAC planks should be located and regularly inspected. So that was sort of the first shot across everybody's bowels going back to 1996. As Martin has mentioned, CROSS, or SCOS as it was then, issued the industry alert in 1999 following the collapse of the school roof in 2018 in Kent. The question talks about, has the industry known about it? I think I would imagine that there's been a lot of private buildings that have this, that have undertaken repairs, strengthening and replacement in the background that have not been widely reported. I certainly undertook replacement of a number of RAC planks in 2010, so 13 years ago, of a shopping centre that had RAC roofs over the storage areas, and they had deflected to such an extent that the roof was leaking onto stock. So the owners of the shopping centre took the view to replace them then. So I would imagine that there are other buildings where we just do not know, but they have been probably replaced or strengthened. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to now bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, convener. You know, just to follow up on the conversation so far, I'm interested to understand the extent to which the RAC material is significantly different from other building materials. I mean, our briefing says that if RAC isn't manufactured, installed and maintained correctly, then that can lead to problems. But I would expect that that's probably true of any building material. So I'd like to understand a bit from your technical perspective to what extent is RAC fundamentally different to other materials, alternatives that could be used in building, and does it therefore need a different approach rather than what you'd normally expect from buildings, as you said, good maintenance and good monitoring of the condition of the fabric? And I don't know, I'm quite open to maybe Chris want to start with that.
Yeah, can I start about the material then? I'll pass over to Martin, I think, who can maybe talk about how it impacts on structural design with it being a different material. So the rack is actually a good name, rather concrete. The concrete bit is a bit misleading because for it to be called concrete, you need aggregate in there, which is the big stones, 10 millimetres, 20 metres big. So it doesn't have that. So it's not really concrete, it's really a mortar. So it has fine sand in there. It's aerated, which means it's got air in there, which is fine. It means it's a very good insulator. And when you're a builder, it's lightweight and it's great to build with. And it's cheaper and it's easy to transport. The autoclave bit is just how it's manufactured. It's a pressure cooker. So you literally cook this stuff at temperature and under pressure, which means it gains strength quicker and you can manufacture them quicker. And it's reinforced, which is back then mild steel bars, which I'll come back to. And then the kind of fancy ingredient, it's got cement in there, just like normal concrete and mortar. It's got aluminium powder in there that under temperature, this aluminium powder creates hydrogen and expands into the gas. So I remember doing this at school. We drop some aluminium into some water thing and it fizzes and gives off a gas. So the kind of underlying chemistry is very basic and very similar to normal cement and concrete. And there's nothing too fancy or magic ingredients in there. But from a material property point of view, the big difference is that the AAC, the concrete bit, is very low strength, about 3 or 4 megapascal. And normal concrete is around 30, 40 megapascal. So you could say it's about 10%, 15% of normal strength concrete. However, before you get scared and think, how this could this be possible? This is okay because the structural engineers type those numbers into the calculations. We know it's that strength and it's fine. For me, it's similar to saying wood. You know, it's really weak. You can snap a pencil or a ruler in your hand. That's fine because that's the numbers we use and put in for the design. And the reinforcement is basic mild steel that is in traditional reinforced concrete. It does have a coating on it, though, because one problem with the aerated nature is that water can get through it quite easily. So it can soak up water, which adds to its own self-weight, which is a problem. But this water can also get to the steel in the middle. And we all know, I guess, steel and water and oxygen isn't a good thing, and it can create rust. So these bars are coated with a fine coating when they're manufactured, a waterproofing coating, and which in most cases we found is pretty intact still after 40 years or so. But in some cases, this has deteriorated and cracked and come away a bit, and it can rust a little bit. So I'll pause there, but maybe pass over to Martin. You can maybe comment on how that affects the structural engineering or the design.
Martin?
Can you hear me? Yes, thank you, Chris. Yes, so this low strength nature of the material means it behaves very differently, and it behaves in two ways very differently. The first one is the way that the reinforcement gets anchorage at the end bearing of the plank. Normal concrete does that by bond between the steel and the concrete, but the very weak nature of the material means it can't achieve that. So, and this was known about in the 50s and 60s. So there's a transverse bar needs to be welded onto the end of the reinforcing cages. And that's what anchors the reinforcement. Now, that transverse bar needs to be positioned over the support for the panel. Now, the issue associated with one of the biggest risks associated with rack was at the time of construction, panels were allowed to have 45 millimetre end bearings. So they only had a very short bearing length, and this transverse bar had to be positioned over the top of it. And the biggest risk we're finding is that due to 1960s and 50s and even 70s, manufacturing control, sometimes those panels, those transverse bars weren't correctly positioned. In rare cases, they're not even there. But also with the same period of construction control, sometimes those panels weren't given the end bearings that what were aimed to achieve. And what that means is, in some instances, that transverse bar can be in front of the bearing and not over the bearing. And what that does, and what the research has shown, is that it doesn't affect the strength of the panel very much, but it leads to a situation where the failure of the panel can, instead of being a ductile failure where it just slowly sags and deflects until it fails, it can fail in a what's called a brittle failure mechanism, but it can fail very suddenly. And that's what instigated the Scott's report. Someone's corrected me, it was in 2019, I think I might have said earlier, but in 2019, it was when a failure had been reported at a school. And subsequent to that, there's been a handful of failures identified. Some of the failures where the panels have crashed to the floor, others where they've just failed and been caught on something below that stopped them actually failing. So that's the biggest difference and the biggest risk that's associated with RAC. The other thing that affects RAC, and it comes into the aging of RAC, is that, as Chris pointed out, that the RAC doesn't protect the reinforcement of corrosion from corrosion in the way that normal concrete does. Now, that's taken care of in the manufacturer, and it was known at the time of manufacture, with a coating of the reinforcement that was put onto it before it was carved into the panels. But that coating is breaking down with time, and we're finding in some locations, quite a lot of locations, that is allowing corrosion to begin to develop. Now, the corrosion has two impacts on the panels. The first is that it can actually allow, push out the cover concrete from it and lead to spalling of the panels, which spalling is where parts of the cover concrete over the reinforcement will fall and fall away from concrete. And can so fall, and it presents a risk to people there. But also in that process of spalling, and also just the general reinforcement, it can affect the bond between the reinforcement and the concrete. And in a situation where that bond strength is very weak to begin with anyway, that reduction in bond is something else that can lead to a concern about the reduction in strength of the panels. Okay, sorry, that's quite a long answer, but does that help answer that question?
It does. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that.
Yeah, Ivan, Paul Livesey, he wants to come in online, and then we'll come to people in the room.
Thanks. So as Professor Goodyear said, some planks are absolutely fine. But what we have here is a perfect storm of contributory factors for a number of planks. So as Martin's mentioned, we have some poor manufacture of some planks with critical transverse bars being in the wrong location. We've got poor construction with reduced end bearings. We have deterioration of the protective coating, which potentially can lead to corrosion of the reinforcement. We have long-term creep issues on some planks, which can move the bearing position such that the stresses, the transverse bar is no longer in the correct location. We also have poor alterations that have been undertaken and poor maintenance. So it's all these contributory factors working together that has led to a perfect storm for some planks. And unfortunately, form failure, as Martin mentioned, which can be a brittle shear failure, is one that happens without warning. So you don't necessarily get many cracks and deflection as you would in a bending failure. Thank you.
Anybody else in the room want to come in? No? Okay.
So if I'm hearing that correctly, then it's as much the nature of the catastrophic nature of the failure that's the issue. At least as significant as the fact that a stuff can fail, because I said most materials can fail. And I suppose you'd be interested just to get confirmation on that, but also to understand, is there data there in terms of how many failures there's been and how that would compare to alternative building materials?
Who wants to pick that up? Anybody
online? I think, does Martin want to come in?
Yeah, thank you. I think, Ivan, that's absolutely spot on. It's the brittle nature of the failure that is the concern to the engineering industry. As engineers, we design buildings so they fail in a ductile way, and that by a multitude of methods. But that ductility gives one warning of problems coming. The brittle nature of the failure of rack is the one that is... is the most concerning, because it can fail with very little, or no warning that's associated with it. The other thing that I will just perhaps I should have added earlier is, because of the nature of rack being very soft, it's much easier for people to modify. So particularly in buildings that are subject to a lot of variations, which is why the NHS. Particularly had a problem with rack, or has a problem with rack. It's relatively easy to cut holes in it, to drill holes, to form openings in it. And the concrete anyway doesn't particularly like having holes cut in it. But rack, because of this reduced bond strength and some other factors associated with it, means that it can be critically weakened in that process. So I mean, that's perhaps less affecting, say, a school, which tends to be built as a school and remains as a school, but hospitals obviously are subject to constant change associated with it. And also the nature of those, where people were forming openings and were trimming those, because rack behaves differently, the typical trimming details that be used if you were cutting out a bit of concrete were often used in rack, including by some instances by my own practice in the past, but without realising that it doesn't work and it's not as effective as it is in normal concrete. So modifications can either unintentionally or intentionally have created defects within panels.
Okay. So the issue effectively, and I think we'll come on and cover this later, it comes down to how effectively we're able to monitor the condition to give advance warning if there is any problems that need to be addressed?
I think that's another good question. I think the end bearing issues, it's very difficult, and I'd go so far as to say that one can't effectively monitor for the end bearing. So if one has to investigate it, assess it, and appraise it, and then if necessary do strengthening. Once that strengthening's in place for the end bearings, the other factors of deterioration, that can be monitored. So one can monitor that by looking at the deflections, looking at cracking, looking for water ingress that causes problems. So there is a way to effectively monitor the situation or the condition of rack going forward. What one of the things perhaps we might come on to is the Loughborough research, which is being phenomenally successful, but it's only barely scratched the surface. It's been going on for 2 years. Most other materials that we look at have been subject to research for decades, and this has really just got 2 years of research. So my plea would be to governments in this country generally is funding for further research is necessary. And one aspect of that funding, and I think to me one of the most important aspects of the funding, is to start looking further at these deterioration mechanisms. So the monitoring that will need to be put in place for buildings that aren't fully remediated, but that monitoring can be effective and economic. At the moment, I think we're having to hit things with almost an uneconomic level of monitoring associated with it. And I think further research would help us target that into
It's a relatively small spend on research. We save a much, much larger number when it comes to monitoring and evaluation.
Absolutely, okay. Yes. I mean, you know, so for instance, you know, most hospitals that are being monitored, the cost of monitoring that is hundreds of thousands of pounds a year, you know, whereas the research might be, you know, you're still going to. So far, the research has been spent, has been funded to the tune of about £750,000.
Okay.
But, you know, so that gives you an idea of quantum.
Thanks very much. My last question is the committee report you mentioned, the Standing Committee on Structural Safety in 2019, advised that all pre-1980 rack panels should be considered for replacement. I suppose the question is, how did Scottish local authorities react to that alert and what work was done there? I asked Peter that question initially.
I think there's probably been various responses. At the minute, local authorities are still inspecting their properties. And I think it's probably important that we acknowledge the challenge there is with identifying racks. Some of that is referred to in your report. A lot of it is in inaccessible places and is typically covered in something, whether it be plasterboard, wood, or in some cases, asbestos paint. The buildings that we're dealing with are typically the era where asbestos was used as well, so you have that additional challenge. So I think time is an issue. I think all local authorities are probably at different stages. I think West Lothian, who are here, are probably at most advanced because they identified an issue very early on and took initiative to accelerate inspection. I can say that in Edinburgh, the Lurn Estate has been inspected, but we're now moved on to other buildings to get that full picture. So I think local authorities are well placed to deal with it. I think time and resource are always going to be an issue. I think the advice that we have, particularly from a technical point of view, is very good. It's consistent. It's an informed approach, it's evidence-based, and it's risk-based as well. So every local authority is equipped to deal with it. But the challenges in identification and then remediation, in particular, diagnosing what that remediation is, it's not something that can happen quickly. So every local authority has got building surveyors who can identify it. But in some cases, as I said, scaffolding towers are needed to get at it. But what the building surveyors can't do is diagnose what the remediation is, and that's where the structural engineers come in, who are more difficult to find for a local authority because typically we don't employ structural engineers, so they are in big demand. And then once you identify it, there's the remediation, and in some cases, that could be, you could be, some local authorities going to be dealing with this for 5 to 10 years, given the nature of what they got, where it is, and the fact that in a lot of cases it's in poor condition. And therefore there's disruption, particularly to learning establishments during that period. And then there's ultimately the cost of it. So, you know, I know of one situation where we're grappling with a scenario where the primary school is got rack in the roof, and to replace it, the roof needs to come off and be replaced. But when you start to look at the cost of that, you're actually better looking at a best value assessment that says, well, you're replacing a roof on a 50, 60-year-old primary school that's not actually in good condition. And your best value assessment might say, actually, you're better to actually replace the whole school. And that might be an outcome in some cases as we move through this. Through SHOPS, it's been monitored, and through SFT, progress. And as I say, most local authorities have moved on to the rest of the state. And just as an example, Edinburgh has found it in one library. But over the last couple of weeks, whilst there have been teams out every day, we've not identified anything further. So that's really an update from, I think, from local authorities' point of view.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, Ivan. Does anyone else want to come in on that? David, yeah.
If you like, yeah. West Lothian, were mentioned there by Peter. In our terms, when the 2019 advice came out, we were also looking at one of our schools and we had found planks had deflected. That led us to carry out a full appraisal of all our public buildings at that stage to try and identify rack in them, and we identified it in 9 of our buildings. At that stage, we got structural engineering advice and we went into our buildings to determine the condition of it. And carried out regular inspections. In some of our buildings, we were able to put remediation measures in place and mitigation measures in place to kind of keep the building safe and operating. And we would go through a process thereafter in terms of our capital plan of trying to replace the roofs where the condition wanted that. And certainly we're taking the same risk-based approach as has been suggested by colleagues of assessing the condition of the rack and following it best engineering practice right through that, which has changed as more and more has become known about the panels. That has led us to replace all but one of our roofs, or at least go through the process of replacing all but one of our roofs, mainly due to the manufacturing issues and the condition of the planks and the deterioration of the planks. And what we certainly have found is that in terms when you find planks maybe are in poor condition, as has been suggested by our colleagues, they can deteriorate quite quickly. That has led to some kind of decants at very short notice in terms of our primary schools and one of our secondary schools. And we've been able to do that with the best engineering advice. We have an inspection regime in place for structural engineers. We also have weekly inspections of our premises by our building surveyors, particularly in the one building where the rack's in good condition, just to make sure that we're keeping a very close eye on any kind of water ingress issues and other matters that come along. But it has been quite a problem, and as Peter also alluded to, the aging condition and structure of these buildings means there is asbestos present. We had a huge amount of asbestos survey to do, even just to do proper surveys of the condition of the planks. And that has been really quite onerous and time-consuming to do that, but and quite a disruption to our education estate. But education colleagues have been very good in handling that and adapting to that, and we'll be able to support them through that. But we are having to decant schools, decant villages for porta cabins and the likes, and just by going to other schools and such likes as well. But it has deteriorated quite quickly in the West Lothian cases. But we certainly do have at least the one building where the condition merits just a continuing to monitor the building rather than anything else. And as I say, we had 5 schools of our 9, three community centres and what we would term a partnership centre as well with this in it. And the partnership centre was a large games hall that's been replaced. 2 of our community centres are on site in a minute, and we're working through one of our primary schools that we're meant to replace with other 2 in the kind of coming weeks and months as well. Our main problem remains our high school, where, again, taking Peter's point, we're looking at assessments, and rather than just replacing a roof, it very quickly became evident in best value terms there was no point just simply replacing a roof and an old inefficient building, and we're now looking to demolish that area of the building and replace that area of the building. Other areas of the school will remain, but certainly we'll replace the rack area as a better means of coming up with a good solution for going forward for the education attainment in the school and achieving best value. So it is quite a challenge to do that, but obviously we're quite content that with the best engineering advice you can put proper monitoring in place and adapt as circumstances change. Yep.
Great, thanks. And Stephen Booth, indicated you wanted to come in.
Good morning. I think it's probably just fair to give the view across all local authorities, and I wouldn't disagree with anything my local authority colleagues have said. As Peter mentioned, different local authorities are in a different position, and in speaking to David, you're probably speaking to a local authority that's maybe further ahead in that journey. In terms of Aberdeen, our response in 2019 was to conduct desktop reviews of all our estate. That identified around 30 properties that we get further structural engineer advice on, which at that point identified 9 buildings across our estate, 7 of which are schools that contained rack. And we had a mitigation and monitoring system in place around that and did carry out some remediation work around roof loadings. Since then, I think my colleagues have highlighted some of the issues in moving from that visual inspection from structural engineers to more intrusive testing and where there's maybe gaps in the market. Aberdeen City have been quite lucky to have some long-established relationships with engineers that know our properties, but I know some other local authority colleagues in rural areas that have a difficulty in getting that support. I think the issue in terms of being able to access RAC and asbestos has been a particular difficulty for us in Aberdeen, where there's a lack of supply, particularly within the asbestos rather than the engineering market, both to get surveys done quickly, but also of testing turned around quite quick. In Aberdeen, we're in a situation where we had seven schools testing over the last weeks, reduced that to three schools, which are all academies, which we're working on mitigation plans and further survey and investigation work at the moment. So it was maybe just give that response that we're probably behind where David is, but I think David's ahead of other local authorities.
Thanks very much for that, Stephen. I'm going to bring in Paul Jones.
I just wanted to, I guess, add some context for the council and where we are at this point in the identification of RAC. So we have found it in some common cases where you would expect, so the mid-century buildings. However, we have identified RAC in some areas where, I guess, we're probably less expected. So we found it in pitched roofs. We have identified it in actually a 1877 property that was subject to fire and then had a roof replacement in the early 70s. We've found it used inside depots as for fire corridors, so just creating small structures. So I think it's where we are at this point in time is really we are looking everywhere across our estate. Whilst we expect there's probably a low probability of finding it, given that we've seen it being used in lots of different ways, there's a possibility. So we're just trying to gain assurance around all areas.
Okay, great. Thanks, David. Do you want to come in and then we'll come to you, Ailsa?
Just to kind of back up what Stephen's saying, I mean, I don't think West Lothian are necessarily ahead for any the fact that other buildings required us to carry out these surveys when we looked at them, and it was the condition of the planks at that stage that required us to take kind of more intrusive measures rather than any kind of tardiness on our colleagues. I don't think that at all. So I think it really was just the very fact that we had roofs, perhaps just unlucky in terms of maybe the manufacturing details and such like, so we weren't quite right in our planks that made that necessary. So I think I'm confident that our colleagues have been just as diligent across the country. It's just been a particular set of circumstances in West Lothian.
Thanks for clarifying that. Ailsa?
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to make a parallel, but I hope quite pertinent point. We've been hearing from a lot of local authority colleagues around the difficulties in surveying, identification and discovery. This is not an issue that is specific to RAC in itself. We have a significant lack of knowledge about our building material, our building condition and our building age. And without holistic centralised data on our buildings, we cannot continue to keep people safe, to meet future sort of net zero goals and aims. We can't plan effectively for skills and material needs for the future. And this is something that is sort of well known in policy contexts. And we are spending an awful lot of time and resource getting the basic data we need to find out what is where and how we can deal with it. And whilst there isn't a fix for this moment, there are significant fixes for the future that would pay dividends if we could find sort of holistic building data that everybody could access effectively, making lists of specific registers that are time-limited access, short-term. These are patches to much greater problems. They are necessary activity, but I think that everybody would be able to get on with mitigation and with measures that would enable far greater, better solutions for those dealing with those buildings than the constant stream of surveying, identification and discovery, which should not be necessary now and should definitely not be necessary for the future.
Thanks, that was really helpful. I'd like to bring in Martin and then...
Thank you. The point I was going to raise was about the presence of RAC. Most of the conversation here and also just generally about RAC is about roofs, because that is by far the most common situation that it was used. But and the earlier speaker who said that it's can be everywhere is in fact the experience of most people. But I would also add that it can be and has been used in floors. And it can and has been used in walls, both as a load-bearing situation, but also as a non-load-bearing cladding panel situation. So the appeal I put out to people is, when you're looking for rack, don't just look for it in roofs. You need to be looking for it in the whole of your building structure.
OK, thanks for pointing that out for us. Ivan, you want to come back in?
Very briefly, Elsa, on the comment you made there, I'm going to ask you a question you might not want to answer, but if we were to have such a register, who do you think should be responsible for holding that register?
Beth has made comments about this in the past. I think there is a natural home within ScotList. 2015, the Scottish Government suggested that ScotList, Scottish Land Information Service, should become the repository for information like this, and it was a stated ambition from 2015 onwards, and this hasn't come to pass. That is our solution. There's other excellent work being done by Professor Sean Smith at the University of Edinburgh around a national buildings database as well. There are solutions out there if people are willing to grasp the nettle on this.
OK, very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I had a question about staff and resources that local authorities would need to identify and remediate, but I think all of our local authority colleagues came in and kind of reflected on that in the previous question. So maybe probe it a little bit further with Sam Pimlica and Chris Goodyear, and just to ask from your professional bodies whether we have, you know, the number of surveyors and the number of structural engineers out there to actually do the identification and the remediation that is required. You know, I've heard previously that because of the way the UK government has reacted, that they have perhaps acted as a magnet for skills down to the rest of the UK. And so just ask Sam and Chris about the availability of skills in Scotland to do the identification and remediation work.
Thanks, Mark. Sam, would you like to come in first?
Thank you very much. So the availability of surveyors, it all depends on the appointing client and whether they have any barriers or limitations on what a surveyor requires from their skill set. As an example, the Department for Education in London, they produced an identification guide, which on the appointment of a chartered building surveyor, it limited who could be appointed to. You had to have 1 year's worth of experience in racks, in surveying of rack. Now, we've got many surveyors with significant experience, 30 plus years in the industry, who may have never worked on a property with rack. However, just with trying to update that guidance, see, well, surely there's a way that we can have, if we provide training, if we provide courses on this is a specific building material, this is how you survey it, does that, remove that 1 year time period that is required for an experience point of view, if you can demonstrate competence by specific training. There are surveyors out there, it just depends on, there are competent surveyors, chartered surveyors out there. It just depends on then what is the requirement of the appointing client, whether it's the local authority or other public sector organisations or private sector companies. And as the rest of the people have already indicated, it's not all of RAC. So whether the knee-jerk reaction obviously promotes a bottleneck for, if you need surveys, if you need engineers to come in and carry out these surveys, well, that knee-jerk reaction obviously causes issues. But as we learn more about the material, learn about where it's already located from in-house surveyors, they're already monitoring these buildings, we can then, our surveyors can then meet that demand. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Chris and then Martin.
Thank you. I'd say I use the word capacity. Apart from when we're in recession, the kind of construction or building industry nearly always has a capacity issue of having enough qualified people in the right place to deliver for the industry. And projects like HS2 or the Olympics really suck up local talent in their regions. So, and then when we get national crises like this, where suddenly we need a lot of expertise in a particular subject, we have a capacity to deliver. There's also a regional issue. We don't know exactly where all the rack is in the country, but we do know that there's a lot in Essex and a lot of schools, because it was really popular in the 60s in the Essex area. So I imagine around there, there's a bit of a capacity issue. So it's having the right people in the right place at the right time. But I'd just like to mention about being qualified to inspect RAC. The way I see it, I have had 20, 30 years of researching and building traditional concrete, and that's where all my experience has come from. And that's where the vast majority of the industry's expertise is. And that's what we teach at universities, traditional concrete. And RAC, as we said, is different. It performs differently. The materials are different. And so even if an experienced engineer or surveyor opens the very good guidance that me and Martin and others have written, you're fighting against maybe 20, 30 years of embedded experience. And all of us around here occasionally think we know what we're doing, I'd hope. And you go and say, oh, yeah, I know this. I know what I'm doing. I've been a surveyor or a structural engineer for 30 years. You know, I know what I'm doing. But this is different. So I think we have a capacity issue of the expertise in the right place. But also I'm you know, a little nervous, cautious of even the experience we bring to bear, because it took me and Martin a while to understand this material. And you can't just understand it by opening the book and reading it and you're done. So that's just a little concern for me, I think.
Thanks very much for that. And Martin?
Yeah, I take what Chris says, and I think it is very true. But the study panel saw the situation of capacity becoming an issue over a year ago. And that's why the latest paper, or the paper that was published in April last year, was intended to allow competent engineers, and I'll come back to that word in a minute, but competent engineers to appraise the risks associated with different elements of the defects in RAC, and to come up with a uniformity of approach. Taking on board Chris's point, I think the institution would say that, first of all, I think one should be looking for a chartered or incorporated members of structures, of the institution, structural engineers, as a sort of level, sort of professional qualification threshold. But I think it is also looking at people who have experience of the appraisal of buildings. And as Chris has pointed out, people who don't just look at a building and go, I know concrete, this is the same. It needs to have people who are aware of the difference that's associated with RAC. Now, to respond to that, Chris is still producing some papers and output from the research. We will, as a study panel, update that. We've done a very high profile, or it's been well publicised, review as to whether our guidance needs to change after the actions of the DfE in the summer, and we've decided not, because actually the instances that led the DfE to make, that's Department for Education, sorry, to make their decisions would have all been identified as high risk or critical risk within the assessment criteria that was set out in the latest paper. But I think the thing I would add to that is, so the engineering community is now beginning to be able to identify the hazards that are associated with RAC. But what needs to be done is to work out whether those hazards are acceptable. and where those hazards are acceptable, because the degree of risk for a building will depend upon its use. If it's a storage building that's little occupied, one might decide that actually a particular set of panels is perfectly safe, whereas in perhaps a more emotional circumstance like a school, one might decide it's not. So the other thing that the Institution of Structural Engineers is pushing hard for is for the health and safety community to get involved with the dialogue. And whether this is the health and safety executive or the new building safety regulator or a combination of the two, but I think what's missing from the national dialogue at the moment is what level of hazard and risk is acceptable over it. So for instance, when the NHS first started to be aware of the issues associated with RAC, which were largely in hospitals, you know, it's common sense. You shut a hospital, people will die. If you keep it open, someone might die. That's a balance of risk that one can manage. Now, that's a very extreme circumstance. But when you start getting into school buildings, into library buildings, into housing, into offices, there's very different risk balance associated there. So I think what would be very good is if governments could be getting the health and safety industry, health and safety professions involved with the dialogue.
Great. Thanks very much, Martin, for that. And with that, I'm going to bring in Ian.
Thanks very much, Chair. I'm sitting listening here, and obviously I don't have a structural engineering background. That's not where I come from. But the lessons we learned from this, from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, was we were in the process of refurbishing McDonald Road here in Glasgow, the fire station in Glasgow, when the 2019 Scottish report came out. We'd identified the rack looked dubious within the roof, and it was a sizeable roof within McDonald Road. There was spalling, there was cracks, there were various elements with it. And removing the roof covering then, we absolutely visibly seen the failure of planks. It was basically held on with the roof coverings. As such, we carried out then the surveys across 357 sites and identified another 14 fire stations that have rack roofing within them. And at 2019, we had competent surveys done with inspectors, and they were very, very good, and we put in the mitigation, whether it was crash decks or props or various other elements around there. But what we also found out then as part of this, and I agree with Martin, it's a different substance from normal, what we found out as well, that these buildings were in the 50s and 60s and had roof leaks previously and had been repaired, so the roof could look perfectly good on top. We started doing drone surveys with thermographics on it, and that identified faults underneath the covering, which we were not aware of and were not visible. So again, to go back and look at the methodology of how we inspect these roofs and how we maintain the safety of our firefighters that are using these buildings, we put in the mitigation, and we're on weekly checks and quarterly checks going forward. And like we said earlier, there is a significant cost then for the monitoring of these roofs going forward. We've also done options appraisal on the removal of these roofs, and as Peter alluded to there earlier, these fire stations do not want the investment of a roof when we have problems with dignified facilities and various other elements within these 1950 stations for, let's face it, a very male-orientated workforce at that time, and obviously we transitioned to be much more modern and inclusive. So looking at the construction methodology and what we need to do with these stations, I think there are about 12 of them we would need to rebuild. We need to look at a new options with our partner agencies going forward, and that's what we're doing at the moment. Obviously, capital's a challenge with regards to that. But I think it was just to reiterate what Martin says there, it's a very unusual material. It's not obviously obvious to see where it has failed or what's been done through the organic growth of the buildings that we've had from the 1950s and 1960s. And our concern was obviously the firefighters that are operating these fire stations. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to add that.
Yeah, thank you very much for sharing your experience. And I'm going to bring Peter Drummond, and then we'll move on to more questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've rightly focused on capacity within the professional sector to identify these buildings and design solutions. What we've not touched on yet are actually industry capacity to deliver temporary solutions. Now, when we sat in this room 3 weeks ago, we discussed CITB figures in respect of skills shortages. And rather predictably, the figures in respect of skilled structures contractors are no better than the other sectors that we discussed. So even once we have a solution, be it a temporary or permanent one for a building, we do not have contractors hanging about at the bus stop waiting to make a start on this. There is a procurement lead-in period, and it will do us no good if we have a perfectly well designed remediation solution if we are 3 or 4 months waiting for a contractor to do that. Now, we can't just throw any old contractor at this kind of work for exactly the same reason as we've discussed professionals. To put this in context, the RIS has been unable to find a single architect that has ever worked on a rack building, presumably because of the age of material. We've spoken to contractors and we've found very few of them outside the hotspots that have been identified today that are familiar with the techniques required. And that has an impact on pricing, it has an impact on lead-in and therefore our ability to deliver timeous solutions to what is, I think we all acknowledge, quite a high-risk situation in some cases.
Thanks very much for highlighting that part of the issue. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair with questions.
Thank you, Convener. Probably pop this question initially to Chris. It's just kind of, do we have any understanding of how incidentally RAC was used in house building, particularly in social building, and I'd probably say from the kind of late 50s into the 70s. Do you have any kind of data on that, Chris?
Can we get audio on Chris? He's waiting for his mic to go on. You can hear. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. I hope you didn't think I was being slow. My mic wasn't on. So good question, which we've had a number of times. So I understand the concern. So we've been aware of very few examples in housing, although there are a small number. There were a small number, again, I think in Essex, by a manufacturer, I think Costain or Ciprex or someone, so a small number. So it's not as common as it is for hospitals, schools, or maybe commercial buildings, but it can exist. And also I'd mention, change of use, we have to be careful of. If a building was one type of building, but it's been, you know, changed into housing, that it might exist there. And just to mention, we've not mentioned AAC blocks yet, which is good because they're very different. So millions of our homes are made from AAC blocks, which is the same material as RAC, bar the reinforcement and its structural properties. But there's no concerns whatsoever over these AAC blocks here or anywhere in the world. So I'm glad we've not mentioned them, but I thought I would there.
Thanks very much for clarifying that.
Just open it up for anybody else want to come in.
Peter?
I would hesitate to mention any locations, but the RIS is aware of a small number of domestic premises, including some now in private ownership across Scotland. It does seem to be relatively rare. I hesitate in advance of a full survey to give any figures, but it doesn't seem to me to be of the same order as the Dorlan and Orlett problems of the 1970s and 80s. But they are there, and indeed some of them have been well publicised in things like the Herald in the past.
Thanks for that, Peter.
Anyone else? No?
Just move on to my final question. Obviously, you know, we kind of our understanding of the kind of detail at the moment, we kind of don't really have that. But do we have any kind of rough figure of, you know, how much the action would cost to remediate?
I just actually saw that Stephen Booth wanted to come in on the previous question, Marie. So let's just bring him in before people come in on the next one. Stephen.
Apologies, Chair, for being a little slow there. Just in relation to housing, just to give some assurance, Aberdeen City, like many other local authorities, are conducting exactly the same review process around our social housing stock as we are around our public buildings. In Aberdeen, that's over 22,000 houses, and we're going through that process at the moment. We have identified RAC in a small number of properties, and we're just working through those issues at the moment, just to make the committee aware there is some housing issues. Right to buy, it's not going to help in that conversation going forward, but just so there's an awareness that there is RAC within some of our social housing stock that individual local authorities are working through.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. And we'll go back to Marie's previous question around the likely cost of mitigating or replacing defective RAC. David, yes.
I think so. We, as I said, due to the circumstances of our portfolio, are a wee bit further ahead. And we're certainly progressing through a replacement programme in a number of buildings. And we reckon, certainly, at this current time, our benchmark's maybe about £2,500 a square metre to replace the RAC roofs. Now, that's just an early indication that will vary in every project, depending on the circumstances and such likes as well. But certainly, we're in for about £53 million so far. And more to come, obviously, because we're still working through these things. But, I say, West Lothian really does seem to be a bit of an epicentre in terms of that. But that's certainly where we're looking at just now.
Thanks very much. Anybody else? Ian?
Yeah, I can certainly... We'll inform the committee at the moment it's around £100,000 a year on mitigation we're paying to monitor these and to make sure that the safe systems are working and the crash decks, etc. are in place and monitored on a weekly and quarterly basis. Looking at the replacement, as I said there earlier, it's not straightforward just replacing the roof. And it would depend on the station. We have small fire stations in rural areas, which would be a much smaller cost to replace. But the figure that we're looking at across the 14 sites is somewhere in the region of £70 million.
Peter Drummond.
It's a very difficult question to answer with any degree of certainty because the type of buildings affected are so disparate. If we compare, for example, the cost of repairing a large classroom or library roof, where it may strangely be quite a straightforward exercise, it's one space, easy access, with perhaps smaller buildings or private houses, you're really comparing apples and giraffes rather than apples and oranges. But to put this in perspective, it doesn't surprise me in the slightest that it could be £2,500 a square metre for certain installations. You remember my evidence on boilers a few weeks ago, I pointed out you could build a house for that kind of money. So we will very quickly reach a point where in actual fact it is more expedient and sensible and better for the public first to replace the structure and with it improve environmental and standards within the building.
Okay. Anyone else? We'll hand back. Yourself, Paul?
Thank you. Yeah, just to add, we're seeing significant costs with providing the decant accommodation, and we're at an early stage in getting cost information about the replacement of roofs for some of our properties. We have other buildings where in particular one high school is scheduled for replacement. However, just the identification of that AC with the high roofs, the sort of high ceiling height, and the amount of scaffolding that we have to put in place and the monitoring. I mean, the costs and the structural engineering costs and surveying costs are significant for us.
Thanks for that.
And Peter.
It's just to say, if I raised a question with the 16 local authorities that have RAC, what they would like raised this morning, the answer was the same from 16 local authorities, and that was funding. So the cost is difficult to estimate at this time, but you do have a benchmark in West Lothian of the magnitude that we are talking about. And local authorities have not budgeted for this. So what they're having to do is look at their capital programme and basically what are we going to sacrifice. And that goes back to my earlier point about best value assessments. In making those decisions, if there was a chance of funding, it might make some of those decisions easier and we would achieve better outcomes. So I fully respect that it's difficult saying here's some funding when you actually don't know what the actual issue is, and that's going to be the challenge. But I do think, and it goes back to my earlier point, it's going to be some time before we get to a point where everything's covered. The focus has been on the Lurden estate, and rightly so, and that is the element of local authorities' estate, which typically would be about 60 to 70% of their estate anyway, where decisions could come earlier to achieve better outcomes.
Thanks for that.
Okay, thanks very much. Now I'm going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Colleagues, I wonder if I could ask a question that my constituents have been asking me to distinguish between RAC and breeze block. Is it the same material or is it different?
Well, it's got Peter.
It's a very different material, although for the breeze blocks, to use the shorthand, there are similarities, as Chris helpfully identified in the process. How we use them is completely different. I'll not go into the science, but essentially your masonry block wall is all in compression. It doesn't tend to flex very much. It's tied together by the roof and the floors. In much the same way as a traditional masonry wall would work, stone or brick. Where the problem arises with the concrete slabs that we're talking about is that they span from side to side, and the role of the reinforcement and the cover in the reinforcement is very different indeed. So most of your constituents and my neighbours will have very little to worry about, I would imagine, in respect to their own houses.
It's good to get that on the record because people don't know. They've probably never heard a RAC, and probably neither did we until recently, but we've all heard the breeze block and we've all seen it and been used in construction. But it's a different material and there's no concerns about that. That's good to know. A question that came up when Ailsa was kind of touching on is why isn't it the case that it's a requirement to record what a building's made of? We suddenly have to find ourselves running around inspecting and surveying to figure out what's in buildings. Why was it never a requirement in the industry or wherever to record what something's actually made of?
I think that's a very good question and one that I'd potentially put back to legislators. Because it's a case of it seems entirely logical that that's what we do, particularly perhaps with public buildings. But you'd think that all buildings, it would be incredibly useful. Yes, we're not putting ourselves nationally in a place to meet the challenges of the future. Yes, I would suggest that legislators could raise this at every opportunity, because it will only be of benefit to have this information.
Great, thanks. Going to bring in Ian and then Peter Drummond.
Yeah, just to pick up on that point there, and speaking from operational colleagues here within the fire service, if there was a database as such as that would be an immense value to the fire service, because at the moment we look at every risk when we're entering a building, whether it's sandwich panels or whether it's rack roof, etc., etc. So to have that database that we could draw on and work with to inform our crews when entering a building what the construction methodology is with it would be added value. We do that at the moment with high profile buildings. We do our own internal surveys and we log on our data systems within the vehicles, within the appliances. But to have access to a central database would be invaluable to our operational colleagues as well.
Thanks for that. And Peter Drummond, and then online, Chris.
Thank you very much. Members will be aware that the Scottish Government proposes to introduce a compliance plan system for future construction work. That will require the assembly of a very detailed portfolio of information in new buildings going forward, and to a certain extent existing buildings that are being altered. I think, building on what Ailsa says, this not only offers us opportunities in terms of build quality and significantly improves on site standards, but also creating a very robust archive. What we probably need to do is look at how we can join up that compliance plan system with other bits of the portfolio to see how we have complete files, as well as the requirements under the Construction Design and Management Regulations to more accurately record what we have. So I think we're very close to the point where we could, for very little additional effort, have a proper catalogue of what we've got on our sites.
Okay, thanks for that. Chris?
Yes, just wanted to mention a few things regards this. First of all, any significant building or structure, you have the drawings and the design, and back in the day, they were on paper, and they would be somewhere. And we have dug out many RAC original designs from these buildings. But again, it's on paper, and it's where does that sit? And I know some structures are required to have a building register, and this relates to, say, asbestos. We know where asbestos is, and we manage that risk. It's partly the sheer number. We have millions of buildings across the UK. So where's that information sit? You know, like my house. Do I have it in my house, which doesn't help the fire service if it's in my house when it's on fire? Do the fire service have it? That seems a good idea. Who has this? It's an issue that post-Grenfell has become very important. You know, do we know what our buildings are made of and what the risks are? So that inquiry has been looking at that, and the term golden thread of information is used for that. And then more nowadays, the technology is available to store this data. So it's not just on paper. So things like BIM you might have heard of, building information modelling. So we design things on a computer now, so that design sits on a computer. Digital twins is a more recent thing where every building can have a digital twin on a computer of exactly what it is. But again, on the one hand, this is easier to store. It's on my laptop. But at the same time, software and IT does go out of date in a few years. As you'll all know from updating your phones and laptops, the software goes out of date. So something that seems simple, we'll just put it on the cloud, that goes out of date. And again, where does it sit? Who owns it? And how do you get access? And then there's a privacy and a GDPR and a data issue and a security issue. If all this data is somewhere, then people can get this data that we don't want to have this data. So it's a great idea that, say, the Grenfell Inquiry has been looking at, but it does have its challenges as well.
Thanks for that, Chris. Ailsa, you'd like to come back in?
Just very briefly, I agree that there are, of course, challenges with this, but I think we've got around them for things like HMRC, DVLA, health records. This is something that is important enough to, I think, put the effort into. I do appreciate that there are challenges, but there is, in fact, as you've also said, an awful lot of information available. It's about how we join it up, be that with, you know, unique property reference numbers. There are many mechanisms that are available. There are also fantastic examples. Denmark has done this very effectively. There are other countries that have already done this. This is not necessarily groundbreaking. It's something that I think is just necessary. Great. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that.
For those responses to that, just on the survey question, Ian, you gave some extensive information to the committee about what's happening within the fire estate, which really glad and thankful to hear. As a matter of routine, does fire service, when they're looking at buildings for whatever reason they may be there, do they look and check for this material now, or have you done it in the past routinely, or will you be doing it from now on?
The short answer is no, we would not look at that. That rack has been a risk. What we have done, we put out awareness briefings to all our stations now to how to deal with if it's known as rack. But again, it's about that knowledge base and knowing when they turn up at an incident if the roof is rack. But we're putting out awareness briefings for our crews. We're also, from the NFCC, which is the National Fire Chiefs Council across the UK, is also putting out briefings and awareness of how this goes forward. We do surveys of high-risk buildings, hospitals, various others, so the crews know the flow of the building. When they arrive, they can know what corridors are where, doors are where. They also know high-risk areas, know if there's oxygen on site, if there are tanks on site, etc. But the construction methodology has not been... There's been a few, as I mentioned, there are sandwich panels. There's been a few commercial buildings where firefighters were injured because of the collapse of sandwich panels. That's something that's been built in now and looked at within our databases going forward, where it's known. But no, we don't do any inspections for RAC or anything like that going forward. That's not part of our fire prevention processes.
I presume it would be something that fire service would support to have more knowledge about what's in a building before you go in it.
Absolutely, and right. As Peter Chris alluded to there, Grenfell, a lot of that's coming out of Grenfell at the moment, and a lot of the learning of building construction and is coming out of that has been adopted by the fire service as well.
Is it actually permissible today, this very day, to build buildings with rack? It's not been banned or anything like that. It's permissible, is it? Is it? Peter?
Yes, it is. And there would be no reason to worry if perhaps we did. In some cases, there have been significant changes, as I think Chris will confirm, to the standards for the manufacture of these products since, from the top of my head, 1990. The BRE reports both highlight in particular concerns about slabs predating 1980. RAC and its equivalents is used extensively abroad,
Now, I'm not suggesting for one moment that it is frequently used in the UK today, nor am I suggesting for one moment that either designers or their clients will be rushing to use it. But if one had a building that was comparatively recently built in this material or one of its derivatives, no, that would not necessarily be a cause for concern. And if it met the certification requirements under the building regulations, then there wouldn't be a reason for concern for a new structure either. It would perhaps be for Mr. Garvin later to talk to, but I would see no reason for us to be worrying about a pre-notification for it in the same way as we have certain types of cladding or sprinkler systems and conversions of late in respect of other cases.
See, Chris, you want to come in on this as well?
Yes, I just reflect on the international aspect. I was at a conference 3 weeks ago on AAC, mainly attended by manufacturers who make aircrete blocks, thermalite blocks around the world, but also they make rack. Fair to say, I was mobbed. I've never been to a concrete conference and been mobbed before. So massive fascination from the industry around the world as to why the UK is worried about its rack when everyone else isn't. Major manufacturers still are Germany in Europe, India, China, North America, Mexico, Indonesia, mainly in the Middle East because of its thermal properties, keeps you cool as well as warm. And they'll say, we haven't got any problems with our rack, which makes me think, and I can't see many issues reported online or in papers, but I see this in two ways. One is they haven't found problems because they haven't gone looking like we have. And I'm confident that if you go looking at 50-year-old buildings made of anything, you're going to find problems. Mm-hmm. Don't tell me they're all built perfectly. It was alluded to earlier. You know, we I think in this country we have a very good policy of reporting problems and failures in buildings and acting upon it and issuing warnings. I think it's probably one of the most mature and sophisticated in the world. A lot of other countries have a acceptance of failure, as in stuff falls down occasionally and that's just how it is, and not much changes. Whereas here, you know, anything falls down, we're on it. So I think we are leading the world on this, but I think other countries will be looking at their rack and will find some. Whether they report it publicly is a different matter. But probably Germany is the nearest European economy to ours. But even the European construction industry is slightly different to ours, particularly their contractors and the trades. Not anyone can be a builder in Germany. It's more regulated than ours. So I think they'll have, in general, better quality than ours. So they might not find as many problems as we have. But I'm sure if you go looking in Mexico and some other countries, you will find some poorly constructed rack. But as I said, I think I'm using Mexico as an example. I think they're okay if the odd thing falls down and it doesn't make the news as it would here.
Okay,
that kind of perfectly answers the next question that I had, Chris, mm-hmm. on the international experience. But maybe just to ask then, do other jurisdictions, other countries actually record what their buildings are actually made of? Or does no one do it?
Good question. I'm not that expertise on that point, I'm afraid.
Okay.
So we did hear from Elsa that Denmark does
Denmark,
it.
Yeah.
Is there anywhere else?
I think there are a few others that I'm aware of, but I'd be happy to get back to the committee with further details on that rather than to sort of try and pluck back into the reaches of my memory.
Okay. Good. Many thanks for that, everyone. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, William. Now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask a question. We've touched upon some of this already with regards to widely used building materials and techniques, which might also pose a problem around this, which the committee should be aware of. Peter, you touched upon asbestos paint earlier, so wondered if, as you're looking at this, if there's other examples which are starting to come forward.
What we find is that the situation with identified rack, none of them are identical in the context of where they've been found, their physical condition, and I suppose the barriers, the main one that causes the issue to identification and ultimately remediation, is typically the location of it. So if you can imagine a primary school and it's in the gym hall, it's at a high level. And the comment about asbestos was really making that link between the age of these buildings and when asbestos was also used. So it's very typical to come across asbestos. And when you're doing intrusive surveys to get to the heart of the matter, you typically need an asbestos survey first before you drill into anything. So that typically is the main challenge. And the second challenge, again, because of where it's located, and what we're finding is over time, a lot of things have been added to the panels. So, for example, behind it, you might have plant and machinery, which is either the ventilation or the heating system. In schools, the schools themselves have attached overhead projectors to it. And these are all factors that have to be taken into account when you're assessing that risk. And as I say, we've not found two examples that are identical, and that's making remediation in a lot of cases bespoke. Mm-hmm. And as somebody commented on earlier, that puts the cost up as well. So that's really what the experience that we've had in that context.
Raman, do you want to come in?
I'm very glad you asked that question, Miles. In the 30 years that I have been in practice, there have been a succession of what I can only describe as wonder products marketed with all the regularity of Scotland's sporting defeats. Some of them have proven quite successful. Some of them have proven to be disasters. And for those like me that do expert work, we can see that some of them are disasters in the making. I'm not going to highlight particular products right now. You all know my views on cladding and insulation. The trouble is that for an extended period of time across Scotland and the wider UK, we have essentially experimented with novel forms of construction. And as a result, with alarming regularity, we find ourselves having to pick up the pieces. Now, it is easy to justify things like RAC or, dare I say it, the PRC houses of the post-war period as being forced on us by economic exigencies. But it happens time and time again, and in stark contrast, dare I say it, to more traditional, tried and tested forms of construction. 30 years ago in Scotland, timber kit housing was very experimental, and it has proven to be a huge success. I don't think any of us would disagree that that has been a good tactic. Certain kinds of insulation, in contrast, have proven to be disastrous in all meanings of the term. Now, hitherto, we could rely on bodies such as the Building Research Establishment, previously publicly funded, to provide us with impartial test regimes. These bodies have largely been privatised. They largely focus on commercial interest. And I would suggest that, with the notable exception of academia, no longer provide the same depth of assurance that we would require. If you look at who the BRE owns, and I have the greatest of respect for the BRE, use their work regularly, they own an awful lot of the other certification bodies. So I'm going to answer your question, I'm afraid, at a tangent, Miles, which is, yes, there are other problems out there. There are other things that are merely potentially risky because we don't quite understand how they work yet. And in many cases, even if that individual product is a problem, it may not be mission critical to the building. It may be something that we pick up in the normal 20 or 30 year cycle of maintenance. What I think we perhaps want to learn from the early days of RAC and from other cases we've discussed is that we perhaps want to be a little more cautious with these wonder products so that we do not simply give our next generation yet another hospital pass, as we did with large concrete-built systems of the 1950s and 60s, now largely vacant from our city centres as a result of the defects we've found. I think what I'm saying, just to finish that sort of Ben Elton-esque meander off, is we need to gang a bit more canny with our procurement policy across Scotland, and we need to stop focusing on short-term magic fixes and look at long-term solutions, not just to avoid this happening again, but also because I would suggest it serves our environmental outputs well.
Mm-hmm. That's helpful.
Thanks very much. And Sam, you wanted to come in on this.
Thank you. Yeah, without answering the question directly, just kind of repeating bits of or emphasising bits that Peter just said, it's all about understanding buildings, how those materials perform before doing modifications to them. So if we're using like new material, like say insulation, making sure that we understand how the existing buildings, how those materials interact with any new materials, and then we don't end up with a nightmare situation in the future just because the understanding wasn't there. The application was then incorrect on the existing materials because the thought process wasn't gone through at the start. So yeah, it's before working on any buildings, attaching a projector to a rack ceiling as an example, has the thought process gone through as to, yeah, is that appropriate? So it's just, yeah, making sure that whoever's working on buildings is competent and understands how that building's put together from an individual material basis through to how all the materials like interact with each other.
Thank you. Anybody else? Nope.
One more question, and we've touched on this as well, in terms of potential building register, and to have that knowledge about what we're building, not only across public services, but individual homes. And we've done work around poor quality of new build, flammable cladding systems, and now RAC. And just wondered, in terms of that model going forward, especially for the public sector in procurement and managing this in the future, what you think needs to change beyond that? We've seen some very high profile cases with new built hospitals, for example. And just wondered why we're getting that wrong. One of the suggestions I made when I was on Health and Sport Committee was an establishment of a central body to oversee some of these health projects, and the Health Secretary took that forward, and I think that's making a difference, because we've got to be honest, sometimes as a small country we don't have these expertise in all of our public services, and we've heard that today. So just wondered what that looks like, and any suggestions we should also take forward. And Elsie, you've started on building register, so I'll maybe bring you back in if there's anything else.
I don't think I'd add anything additional specific to that, but I think there are always areas about where responsibility sits and almost where things can fall between two stools as well. There's something about having a more overarching sense of responsibility and understanding for our buildings from before procurement to past the maintenance schedule that I think also helps to give more continuity for that. But I think there may be others in the room who would like to add more.
Anything else? Peter Drummond.
I hate to batter on, Miles, about procurement, but over the last 30 years, what we've seen is a substantial de-skilling in large parts of the sector towards semi-skilled tradesmen instead of more traditional forms. At the same time as we've seen a move to things like design and build, which, and I appreciate the design and build sector will write me vituperous correspondence when I say this, but which does tend to remove much more independent scrutiny by consultants, clerk of works and others from the process. Now, if we look at mainland European, particularly northwest European forms of procurement, there is much more emphasis on quality throughout the procurement process than I would suggest there is in Scotland or any of the other home nations. Now, lest I get another nasty letter from Scottish Futures about that, I know there is a work stream on that at the moment, and I believe there's due to be some reports to your committee and others on that fairly soon. Now, more than ever, budgets are hard. We've heard today about how the budget implications of addressing RAC will create problems. But what we can't do is allow ourselves to take our eye off the ball and there go for less than robust solutions again. I think it'd be unfair if it was to call them bargain basement solutions. I think less than robust is probably the fairest way of putting it. But we need, as we, with Scottish Futures and others, revise our procurement policies across the public sector and cascading down to the private sector, need to bring quality back to the front of the agenda. We cannot keep throwing up shoddy buildings in this country, or else we're just going to face yet more cladding, yet more rack, yet more Dorland debacles in future.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to come in on that? So I think we've reached the end of our questions. Just wanted to see if there's anything else that hasn't come to light through what we've been asking you. Got a few more minutes if anything else needs to be said. Peter.
Apologies. And firstly, incidentally, for the record, I keep saying Dorlan Houses when I mean Doran Houses. Apologies for that. The RIS would like to highlight the potential predicament of private owners of houses that now transpires having rack in them, who through no fault of their own have a building which will be very expensive to remediate. The original design errors, if I can call them that, were made by the public sector. We believe that in the vast majority of cases, people will have bought their properties in good faith. Those few of you like me that are old enough to remember the right to buy of the 80s and 90s know fine that there was not necessarily a requirement for a full survey. It will not have been picked up. But exactly like people in PRC houses, that is the Doran and Orrit ones I was talking about earlier, these people are now in a disaster that was not in the slightest of their own making. Government has faced this challenge on a number of previous occasions. Now, I don't think we're looking, as I mentioned earlier, at anything like the number of houses we were for PRC, which was about 15,000 in Scotland. I suspect it will be a small fraction of that. But I think you may wish to consider whether government puts in place a scheme of assistance to help that small number of people and get them back on track. In doing so, I don't detract from the very significant challenges that the public sector faces, but the public sector has other avenues, other ways of funding these. Mrs McSugarty and their poor badly built house, wherever it might be in West Lothian, do not have these opportunities and may now find themselves stuck. There may not, in some cases, be easy remedial solutions for those houses, particularly the ones with wall panels, as opposed to just ceilings and roofs in it. And therefore, the scope of that would have to be considered carefully. It may, in some cases, involve buying them out. Now, that may seem disproportionate for what I'm hoping is a handful, and as I've said before, one of my handfuls at that, of people, but I do not think we should leave them high and dry. We haven't left people with flammable cladding high and dry, and there's no reason for a different approach here.
Great, thanks very much. And Chris Goodyear, you wanted to come in?
Yeah. Yes, thanks. And Martin mentioned it earlier on about the research and knowledge on RAC. As you mentioned, we spend as a country about $750,000, which might sound a lot, but this RAC bill is going to run to hundreds of millions. And if you compare it to other materials, that there's been tens or hundreds of millions spent on understanding other materials. So it's an urgent need to get some of this started now. And I can list a number of topics regarding the durability, degradation, how it changed over time, climate change. I think one of the reasons we're finding more failures now is our buildings getting battered more and more, temperature and rain. So what's the effect of that? And some I'd say global, we've mentioned data a few times. There's real knowledge to be captured by collating and analysing the global national data on this RAC. You know, we survey individual buildings, but aggregating is about, there's a lot of learning to do there. And studying all the systems we're putting in place to remediate and survey and look after these buildings, studying those, which are the good ones, which are the most cost-effective. So a little bit of money spent now will save millions over the next few years as we address this problem.
All right, thank you very much for that, to both of you for highlighting those two points. I think that brings our meeting to a close, and I just want to thank you all for coming in or online for this discussion. I think it's been very useful, enlightening, insightful. And with that, I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. On our second and final panel this morning, we're joined in the room by Shirley Ann Somerville, who's the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice. And Ms. Somerville is joined by Scottish Government official Sam Anson, who's the Deputy Director of Workforce, Infrastructure and Digital, and Stephen Garvin, who's the Head of Building Standards. And I welcome our witnesses to the meetings. We were also due to be joined by COSLA this morning, but unfortunately due to illness, they were not able to field someone. And I now invite Ms. Somerville to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much and good morning, convener. Thanks to the committee for the opportunity to be able to give evidence today. I hope this can build on the written evidence that I've already provided to committee to give a context for the issues facing the public sector. Everyone with responsibility for building safety takes RAC very seriously. We have been working at pace with local authorities and other public sector organisations in Scotland as they have conducted reviews of RAC in their properties. This allows us to understand the extent of the issue and, where required, that mitigations or replacement work is carried out. While the issue of RAC has been ongoing for some time, the UK Government Department of Education changed their approach for RAC specifically in schools on the 31st August. They did not seek to engage with the Scottish Government before that change, or indeed, it would appear, others in the UK Government departments. We have repeatedly requested that further information that supported the DfE's decision is available, and the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has written several times to the Secretary of State for Education on that point. As committee, I think, has already heard this morning from Panel 1, the Standing Committee on Structural Safety, SCOS, set out their alert on RAC in 2019, and later the Institution of Structural Engineers published guidance on RAC in March 22, with a revision in April 23. The guidance was written from an evidence base from research and engineering assessment of failure. Once that authoritative guidance was published by ISTRUCT, then appropriate advice could be given by engineers to building owners. Whilst action was taken over the period following 2019, in particular by SRFS, the clarity that the guidance gives means that proper assessment of risk can be undertaken. Local authorities, the NHS and police all acted on RAC over 2022. Work had already been underway to deal with RAC in the school estate in Scotland prior to the UK Government's announcement. Local authorities have a clear responsibility as building owners to manage their estate and to ensure they are safe for all building users. As a result, I am reassured that COSLA have confirmed that safety is the central consideration and there is robust guidance which is followed by every local authority to ensure these settings are safe for the young people, staff and public to be in. Using that guidance, RAC has been identified in 37 schools. We have used the figure of 41 previously, but committee heard this morning from Aberdeen about four of the schools there. So RAC has been identified in 37 school buildings across 16 local authorities, including 8 early learning and childcare settings within primary schools. Wherever RAC has been found, mitigations have been put in place. Those local authorities have also been communicating with parents and carers and have published information on their websites. We are now working with COSLA, SFT and local authorities to ensure that the full school estate is fully assessed as quickly as is practicable. Whilst the focus initially with local authorities has been on schools, councils are continuing to investigate the extent of RAC in their wider estate again, as you've heard this morning. A major study is also underway on NHS buildings in Scotland so that risk can be assessed and managed. NHS Scotland Assure and partners are actively assessing 254 NHS Scotland properties identified as potentially containing RAC. Site surveys have started with 14 buildings confirmed as containing RAC in parts of them, where necessary mitigation actions have, of course, been taken. We're currently in the discovery phase for the housing sector. My officials remain engaged with COSLA, the Scottish Housing Regulator, and housing and local authority organisations to understand the extent of RAC in social housing. We anticipate that initial reporting on current activity and timescales will be received during October. The First Minister has been clear that we will, of course, spend what we need to spend to ensure that our buildings are safe for those that use them. But we need the UK government to realise the seriousness of the situation and to provide devolved governments with funding and, of course, their own departments. The Deputy First Minister wrote to the Chief Secretary to the Treasury about this in August, only receiving an unsatisfactory response some weeks later. The UK government cannot simply put their head in the sand, and new capital money has to be made available rather than continuing cuts to capital budgets that we have seen and will continue to see in future years. The Cross-Government Working Group on RAC continues to meet, and we will do so to ensure any risk across the public sector is managed. I trust that the committee is reassured by the ongoing actions that the government is taking, along with our public sector and industry partners on RAC, and any risks that it might present. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much for that, Cabinet Secretary. And it's good to hear that the that we're going to be getting a more detailed picture beyond the learning estate, and you said that's going to be coming forward in October. There's a number of things that came up already in the previous panel, and you're aware of that. And I'd be interested to hear a few your response to a few things. One of them was, we heard from West Lothian that they've calculated that it's going to be about £2,500 per square metre to take the remedial actions. And I think, I hope I'm getting this right, that a total cost of £53 million. And I think something that came up in the conversation this morning was the fact that local authorities haven't set aside, these 16 identified, haven't set aside funds to cover these costs, and the kind of question as to where would the cost come from that, from for that. Is that something that the Scottish Government can support with? Or?
I think because of the sheer extent of the work that's going on across the public sector, it's not possible to have a genuine modelling of what the scale of financial commitment may be. So I do think it's perhaps not helpful to speculate at this point until all that work has been done. As I think, again, you've heard this morning, although those figures were mentioned, other panel members did say that it was difficult to put an overall figure in it, given where we are with the discovery work, and given the fact that it very much depends on the type of building that's involved and actually what the issue is with that. You heard some examples this morning about how that varies from example to example. So I think at this point it is not possible to put a final figure on that, but we do recognise that this is a concern across the public sector. That's why we're working very carefully with COSLA and, of course, other parts of the public sector to ensure that we have very, very close working so that we are alerted to the issues as they are found by the building owners who are responsible for the monitoring and the upkeep of their buildings.
And towards the end of the session, another issue came up, which was more focused on private homeowners and the fact that the idea that the original errors were made by the public sector, and therefore the suggestion of a government scheme of assistance that and even potentially buying people out for those people. And I think it was identified as a few, like a small number of people that could be left having been involved in the right to buy scheme.
So we are at the discovery phase, as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, working with the regulator, working with councils to try and assist to find the scale of the issue that we have within social housing. And of course, that would also ensure that we had greater awareness of what may affect certain schemes where people have exercised their right to buy in previous years. This is something which we are already very conscious of. Officials have been asked by myself to look at this issue already to make sure we're discussing that with the local authorities. And very, very conscious that as we sit here and we talk about these things in the round, that we are talking about people's individual homes and any concerns that they have. So we are very keen to make sure that we can reassure wherever possible, and one of the most important ways for that to be done is by councils carrying out that work as they are doing so, and registered social landlords, to ensure that we have a greater awareness again of the extent of the problem. And then, of course, as I've said, I've already tasked officials to work with COSLA and with others to see what we can learn from previous examples where there have been right to buy in areas of non-traditional construction methods.
Thank you very much for that. I'd like to bring in Ivan McKee.
I think my point's been covered.
You don't want to cover anything about risk?
No, I haven't covered that enough in the last session.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. You might have heard a wee bit of the discussion in the first panel about whether we need other needs to emerge a register of what buildings are made of in this country. We don't have that. And it comes up from time to time at the committee about whether people are entitled to know what their buildings and their homes are actually made of. Is that something the government would take forward? I realise that can't be done overnight, but as part of this process and part of a wider process, is that something that the government would support looking ahead?
We were listening very carefully to the session previous to this, so I'll perhaps bring in Stephen, who can go through some of the areas of work where this has already been looked at and where the discussions are at this point.
Yes, thank you. At present, we have building standards registers. Each of those are held separately by the 32 local authorities, so the building standards verifiers at the moment. So that some of that information is available. It's not easily interrogated. So if you have an interest in the building, you can get access to the information that's held, but it's in different formats. So we are looking at the moment through our futures Building Standards Futures Board work at potentially a national register of... National Building Standards Register for higher risk buildings, but that's work that's in progress at the moment. I think in terms of developing something for new buildings going forward, it makes sense. It feels using sort of digital technology that would be a possibility. There is the digital planning programme at the moment, which Building Standards is part of, and we might see that programme develops in that way, that you can retain that information to be able to interrogate it for specific materials or construction techniques. Addressing the current housing stock and other buildings in Scotland is a much more enormous task. We've got over 2 million homes and probably over 200,000 non-domestic buildings. So bringing information together in a sensible way on that is quite a challenge and would be a significant investment. We did note comment around work in Denmark earlier, so we can have a look at that. I'm not sure whether that's a specific aspect that Denmark's looking at, or they have a... You know, they've built up building models that they use, but certainly something to look into. Mm-hmm.
That's a really helpful response, I think. And I mean, people today, perhaps buying a house, buying a home, should they be interested in understanding and knowing what their house is made of? Who would they ask? The builder, the selling agent? Who would have the information? Who would have it?
Well, if they're building from a house builder, the house builder should have that information. As a party who has an interest in the building, they're entitled to get the relevant information from the Building Standards Register as well, if they're so minded to do so. But primarily to understand the form of construction, the materials used, and design information, it would be from the builder.
And is that a requirement that they must record that, so that when the house is sold on and on and on, that new owners can can gain access to that, Stephen? Is that possible?
There's no requirement as such under the building standards system to do that.
Okay, it's probably something we would maybe choose to follow up, but I imagine with the committee.
Just to clarify on that, does the Home Report not provide some or much of the information, and that could it be a basis for providing more information to address the point that Willie Coffey raised?
I think you raise a very important point. There's the aspects around new build, which I think is where Mr Coffey was going with some of the questioning initially. But if you're looking from seller, from buyer to seller, then of course there is the Home Report that is there. And if there are lessons to learn about how that Home Report process needs to be improved or adapted, then of course none of that is set in stone and can be something that's looked at. So there is information within the Home Report, but these aspects can always be built upon should we feel the need to do so.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Ivan. Looking ahead, Cabinet Secretary, if this process does build up to some degree that requires remediation across the public sector landscape, does the government see itself having a role in trying to coordinate the procurement of structural engineering and construction services so that we don't see bidding wars? Because we heard about some of the skills shortage issues, particularly from Peter Drummond earlier in the panel there. Do we see a role to try and assist local authorities to do this in a methodical and consistent manner?
Well, I think we have a degree of reassurance around some of these issues at the moment. And again, I'll bring in Stephen, as he is actually involved with the group where this has already been raised. We had questions around capacity and capability right at the start of this process, but that's exactly why Stephen can perhaps give some more detail into the reassurances that we've already attempted to receive. I think one of the aspects which is key is around the level of expertise and knowledge that's already within our 32 local authorities, and that is very, very important part, and we compare that, for example, by the rather disparate nature that they have down in England, particularly in education, where we don't have that ability for schools to be able to access local authority knowledge. It's because of the different way that the system is set up. So we're very, very close to the fact that we need to keep an eye on this. Whether there's a role for government in that or whether it's a role for someone else, but basically we are already asking the questions about that. But again, if I can perhaps bring Stephen in as he has been sitting on the group that has discussed exactly that already.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so we set up the cross-sector working group. It met for the first time back in August and it's met several times over September on RAC issues. Capacity and capability to service the market has been raised. So far, stakeholders, public sector in particular, not reporting any significant issues there with accessing expertise of engineers, surveyors, etc. But we are aware as the work ramps up that there could be issues. So that would be an ongoing discussion. I think the institution structure engineers have talked about training and developing the existing cohort of experienced engineers on RAC, and I think that's something which, you know, would clearly benefit in terms of servicing the whole market.
You might have heard Peter Drummond's additional comment about architects. There's no architects in Scotland that have got any experience of working with RAC because of the age of it. You know, is that a worry or a concern?
I think if again, architects, the same as engineers, surveyors, etc., you know, there's now clearly an awareness of RAC, and we would expect the professional bodies, institutions, etc., to be working with their membership to develop appropriate training materials, etc. I think there isn't any evidence of anyone in the UK designing and using RAC in new building, etc. But I suppose that there could be relevance where you're retrofitting a building, particularly perhaps energy efficient upgrading, and architects' awareness, surveyors, etc. At that point would be essential. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And my last question, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned in your remarks that the UK government has changed its approach for schools and announced whatever the change was on the 31st of August. Can you outline what the change is and how? What are the implications of what they're doing for Scotland?
Well, the Department for Education, and I would stress it's the Department for Education and not the whole of the UK government, but the Department of Education did signal a change, as I mentioned in my original remarks. We have not received any evidence that would suggest that we should do anything different to what we are doing and have been doing for some time, which is looking at the iStruct guidance. So we haven't seen compelling evidence that justifies the Department for Education in England's departure from that iStruct guidance. We have clearly asked for all the information that's available to ensure that everyone is sharing that information, that we have full knowledge. But as again, I think you heard this morning, iStruct engineers have confirmed that their guidance remains as good practice in this area, and that they use the risk-based approach to manage RAC. I think again, I would point to the fact that there's a very different management model for schools in England and Scotland. So in England, there's over 3,000 bodies responsible for the school estate. In Scotland, we've got 32 local authorities occupying that role, each one of them with a professional estate management team. And that is one of the many reasons why we do not feel that it is necessary or indeed wise to follow where the Department for Education have gone. And it is that one department in the UK government, not UK government-wide.
OK, and last query then on funding itself. Has there been any indication or otherwise from the UK government about potential funding to try and address this issue as it develops?
No, there's been a disappointing response so far on that. We have clearly sent letters to the UK government on this specific issue and asked that this is looked at and that additional funding is made available to devolved governments, as indeed it should be made available to departments within UK government as they look to deal with this as well. It would be fair to say that the letters we've had back on that have been disappointing and there is not any sign that the UK government has recognise that there is a need for mitigation funding for RAC, for the Scottish or indeed Welsh governments as so on either. And we will clearly, that's a concern, and clearly we will look at that because, as I think someone mentioned earlier on, local authorities are not sitting with a pot unallocated to deal with the mitigation of RAC, nor is the Scottish Government. Our capital allocation and funding is allocated. It is a capital funding under pressure given the very great increases to construction costs that we have seen over over the recent years. And I won't go into the reasons for that, but that is a fact that the context of which we are in. And at that point, it is clearly concerning if there is an expectation that the Scottish Government should assist all public sector bodies with this without UK government support coming in to assist with that process.
OK, many thanks for those answers. Thank you. Convener.
Thank you, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's online.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to ask what work has been done in government to minimise some of the closures that we've seen in the rest of the UK of public building due to RAC-related concerns across the local authority estate. I'm thinking, you know, schools, social work services, first-stop shops. You know, what work is undergone to keep those buildings open, and if you're aware of any work across the wider public estate as well in the NHS and GP provisions.
So the responsibility for decisions around decanting or a closure of building would be for the local authority or the responsible building owner to take, not for the Scottish Government. So clearly, for the example of local authority and a school, that would be something which is taken on a school-by-school basis. And again, panel earlier on this morning went through some of the details of the discovery work and the more intrusive surveys that can go on within a building that would then lead to a building owner taking a decision either to put in mitigation measures in place or to decant or close part or all of a building. So that really is something for the building owner, quite rightly, as they have the information about the survey. And I give examples again from the school estate, but there are others elsewhere where it may be an exceptionally small part of a building and therefore the full closure is not required, or indeed it can be dealt with through mitigation measures and no part of a building needs to be closed. So that would be an issue for the building owner.
Yeah, we heard from the previous panel that the cost of some of those mitigation measures is pretty huge in comparison to potential research that might be undertaken. So rather than the continuous mitigation or monitoring of some of those buildings, that perhaps an alternative avenue would be to invest in the research to make sure that it's been managed at a more appropriate cost level. I wonder what work the government has done on that, whether you would reflect on some of the opinion from the experts in the previous panel on that subject.
So again, this was a really significant part of the evidence that came over this morning, is about how knowledge and expertise of this situation has developed over time. So the issue of research is, of course, a very important aspect of that as we begin to learn more about this. This is already being discussed at UK-wide level, of which obviously Scottish Government officials are involved in those discussions, because this isn't an issue that the Scottish Government is looking at alone, but we are, with the possible exception of the Department for Education down south, trying to work very hard collaboratively and jointly to discuss research, discuss capacity within professional organisations and so on. So I do recognise that was discussed earlier on within your panel, and I hope I can reassure the committee that that is being discussed across governments, including devolved administrations, to see what more needs to be done in that area.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. I just want to come in on that, on another aspect which was raised with us around the cost of some of the repairs being so high that it becomes, in terms of a best value assessment, the council will maybe decide it's not worth replacing the roof, but actually you could build a new building for that cost. And I just wonder what your thoughts are with that.
Well, it's certainly a very important aspect that the building owner would need to be cognisant of. There were some examples that I think given around schools, but not just the school estate in the first panel. And best value is clearly an area of that. It was mentioned around the advantage if it was not a replacement roof, for example, but a replacement building, you could look to improve environmental standards and so on as you go on. So the best value is a very important aspect of that. But again, I would stress that that would be a decision for the responsible building owner, looking at how much the mitigation measures are costing, what the capital costs would be if we were to go through major building improvements compared to a complete new build. And that would be on a case-by-case basis, again, for the responsible building owner to take that decision.
And in terms of getting an infusion of money in to kind of make that decision, is that something that's in the scope of the discussions with the UK government in terms of not just being remediation, but actually potentially replacing a building because it makes better sense for the value?
Well, government should all be working on the concept of best value. Again, we have to work very closely with local government colleagues. Again, I give them as an example, because most of the discussions around this have been on schools to date, and their analysis of best value around that, about whether it would be building work or a complete rebuild and new building. Quite frankly, convener, I would, as a first step, settle for the UK government recognising that there is a need for all the governments right across the UK to be working on this, that there is a requirement for additional capital funding for departments and for the devolved administrations, so that we can then, once the discovery work is at a more substantive point, get into discussions about what that would actually look like.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Convener, my questions have been covered as well.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you. And Miles.
Thank you. One of my questions has been covered in terms of not being able to put a figure on the funding, but I wanted to ask a few more detailed questions with regards to how we take a change forward, because NHS Scotland now have NHS Scotland Assure looking at new buildings. Now, I know that's not a perfect science, given it's a new organisation. It's often looking at buildings towards completion, not on the drawing board, but just wondered where the Scottish Government were looking at what this will mean for local authorities and a new model. We obviously heard in the first panel suggestions around a public register of what buildings are made of when they're constructed. So just wondered, is there any work going on around that at the minute to actually look at what clearly needs to change?
So one of the aspects, I think, is hopefully already been answered by Stephen earlier when we were talking about register. But again, either myself or Stephen can perhaps help if Mr Briggs would like further information on that. And I think there's another aspect which we're very keen to ensure that works closely together. So although building standard system is a devolved system, the construction products is a reserved matter. So to have good building standards, we also, of course, need to have good construction products and a good construction, a good system of reassurance around construction products. So, of course, this is, again, one of the areas where we are very keen to work with others, including professional organisations, to see if they have any concerns about how building standards and construction methods work together, and again ensuring that the bits that are devolved and the sections that are reserved are also working as effectively as possible, to ensure that, yes, if there's anything that we can do in a devolved setting, there is, or if there are any concerns around aspects that are reserved, that we can again work with the UK government to be able to hopefully design a solution that deals with any of the concerns from professional organisations and others on construction products or non-traditional methods.
Thank you for that. Has the government looked at, and as a committee we've been obviously considering flammable cladding systems and now RAC, and are you satisfied that actually our public building procurement is fit for purpose and is looking at not only just best value but actually long-term sustainability of these buildings and live information around the world when concerns are being expressed? I thought it was quite interesting. I think the people in the earlier panel, by and large, seem to think we are very good as a country in terms of this health and safety element. But looking specifically at where our public services all are doing this on their own, where we maybe need more specialist services around that.
Well, I think this is an area which clearly there has been concern raised about. There clearly has to be a level of public trust around the processes which are in place, and whether it's procurement or again the building standards or construction methods which I mentioned earlier. So this is an area where we always have to ensure that the public trust is maintained, and that people can have the assurance that whoever procures a building is doing so in the right manner, and for the right reasons. We mentioned best value earlier on, we mentioned energy standards again earlier on. All of these aspects need to be looked at during that procurement method. So at this point, I am reassured, but if there is, of course, any areas where lessons need to be learned, then government stands ready to do that. And I think we have the processes in place within government for those concerns to be raised directly to ministers, through officials, through their work with professional bodies, for example, so that we can have those concerns raised to us and we can act accordingly.
Thank you. And in terms of workforce to do this, we know that in terms of cladding, we don't have that workforce to do all the inspections at this moment in time. It was revealed, I think, last week that more than half of NHS buildings which might contain RAC have not been inspected. And so I just wondered where government were with public agencies, councils, NHS especially, to provide that support, because we're not going to magic these people up overnight, and wondered what expectation ministers were having that we would have these inspections completed at a certain point in time to know of the risk, which is currently unknown.
So if I can take the NHS for an example, of course other parts of the public bodies and the public sector are working to different timescales. But we take the NHS, for example, based on the progress to date, we expect that the surveys will be completed by the end of November. The work that is ongoing is clearly looking at the highest risk buildings, or those perceived to be at highest risk first, to ensure that that work is being undertaken. When it comes to the school sector, we have had a reassurance that the small, and it is a very small number that are outstanding, that require more invasive work, can be done through the October holidays, when obviously staff and students are not in situ, and that can be completed by the end of October. So there is a variety of work streams in place, obviously, for different sectors. I hope given an example there of the NHS and schools about where we are with the speed of that work to date.
Yeah, that's helpful, and I think in the interest of transparency, hopefully that can be shared with the committee or published so that we're aware of the individual buildings we're talking about, and then numbers for councils.
Because I think this is a really important point. Forgive me, Mr. Briggs, for interrupting there. So this is a very important point around transparency. We've been very keen to work with local authorities on the school estate to ensure that that information was published, but in a way that was done by local authorities, because they could also make sure that the information was given to parents about the extent of the issue within a building and the mitigations and measures in place. Because clearly what could give rise to concern is the example of a building being named, and then there's great concern that it's actually throughout the building, when it's actually in a very, very small part, or indeed in some of the cases in the school, say it was in a part that hadn't been used for years. So the local authorities have that information that will be published, and they will continue to update that. When we look at the NHS, health boards will publish that data for each of the health board areas, and then NHS Scotland Assure will publish an update for the whole of the Scotland, and that will ensure that that's brought together at a strategic level for the whole of Scotland. But I am very keen to do that, but to do so in a way where we're providing the information, or the responsible building owners providing the information to, for example, parents and importantly staff and trade unions around where that's a concern within a building as well. So that context and reassurance can be given rather than just a list of names.
Thank you for that. And in terms of homes, I think you touched upon council-owned property, housing associations who might be in management of these as well. For work going on with those properties where people have bought their homes under right to buy, is that the model you see for informing these individuals as well? And any inspection regime which, you know, councils might do, but individual private homeowners would have to be part of?
So we're working very carefully with COSLA, both myself and Ms. Gilruth have met with COSLA a number of times, particularly around the school estate, but we're widening that those discussions at ministerial level to the wider estate, and of course officials are doing that and have been doing that for the wider estate too. We're keen to learn the lessons about what worked well around the publication around the school estate to ensure that we're working with local authorities to see what could be done, not just for housing, but of course there are other buildings as well. So the knowledge is out there with that context, and they're working with the individuals that may be impacted on that. Now that will vary from council to council, from situation to situation. You've seen some examples, for example, in Clackmannanshire, where there was a specific issue in a small number of flats, and that was dealt with by the council working with the individuals involved. So we're very, very keen to learn from good practice about what's worked and what we need to improve on, because that ability for people to be reassured is absolutely vital, both to the Scottish Government and indeed everybody that's involved in this, to ensure that we're being as transparent as possible about the information we have.
And one last question. We obviously don't have COSLA here today, so we'll maybe put these questions to them separately. But I think for a lot of councils, given where we are with the funding formula, there will be questions over how they reprioritise potential buildings, which they're going to have to bring forward quicker. We've heard about schools here in Edinburgh, for example, around replacements. So just wondered where ministers were having conversations with COSLA, that for some councils, this might present a far more bigger challenge to fund, and what that will look like for COSLA to be in negotiations over potential changes to that capital funding in the future.
Well, clearly all councils are going to be affected by RAC, given that this was used throughout Scotland. It will vary from council to council, and it will vary in its severity depending on the state of RAC at this point. And I think I would again strongly encourage committee to pay particular cognizance to some of the very early evidence that was given about the fact that because there's RAC in a building does not mean it is unsafe and does not mean there's immediate concern. And again, I go back to that point around reassurance. But we're very keen to work with local authorities to understand the extent of the issue. But it's not just local authorities, it's the wider public sector. And the challenge around this will be for how responsible building owners do fund that. Again, I go back to the point, convener, that's why the liaison with the UK government is so important on this, because this will not be a small issue. And just as local authorities are not sitting with a pot and maybe looking at having to change priorities, if there's an ask of the Scottish Government without anything coming from the UK Government, we are also not sitting with a capital allocation that is sitting there simply for RAC. So that would have to be looked at as well at a Scottish Government level too.
Convener.
And Willie, you wanted to come in.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just for completeness for me, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned various mitigations that are underway. Could you explain, is that replacing the RAC or reinforcing it with other materials? And if it's been replaced, what are we replacing it with?
This is perhaps something that Panel 1 could have assisted with, but I will give an overview, Mr. Coffey, and Stephen can perhaps assist. It can be a number of issues. I think you heard from Scottish Fire and Rescue colleagues earlier on about how some of the work can be done in the building can still be used. It can be a variety of different things depending on what's happening. It can be ensuring that water ingress that may be impacting is dealt with. It can be a variety of aspects, but I will ask Stephen to assist slightly and then perhaps refer you back to the professional bodies who were on panel one.
Yeah, thank you. I think there's a number of options to address the risk in existing buildings, such as propping and as the SFRS referred to, crash decks, etc. It will depend on what's right for that actual situation, and to a certain extent, do you need to keep the building operational, or is there an alternative that you can move to? So sometimes I think either temporary or even permanent closing a building might be an option. But there's a number of things you can do to either manage it physically or by changing your service delivery in the short term. I think though, where rack has been found to be in poor condition or poorly installed, etc., then a longer term solution to that is needed. But it is clearly temporary measures have been used to allow the operation of the building to continue in places.
But if it is to be replaced, what do you replace it with?
Well, that would depend on the building, so that would depend on a structural engineer and other professionals going in and assessing that on a case-by-case basis.
Okay. Thanks.
Got to take the nuanced approach, Willie. Ivan, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to follow up on a point you touched on there, Cabinet Secretary, you heard on the first panel, we talked a bit about risk and that very important point that not all rack is a problem. It depends very much on what has to be badly maintained or badly manufactured or badly installed, which, of course, is in common with many other building materials. You kind of referred to that point. Do you think there's more work to be done to provide reassurance on that basis? Because I think that the public dialogue perhaps is in a place where everyone assumes that all rack is bad and there's a critical issue, and the point was made by one of the participants this morning, this narrative that when it gets to 31 years, everything falls down. There's more work to be done there to kind of provide reassurance that in probably the vast majority of cases, there isn't really an issue.
I think you touched on a very, very important point, Mr. McKee, on this. And I think I would urge colleagues and their colleagues right across the chamber to just be very careful when we're talking about rack and the terms that are used, because there have been terms used in the parliamentary chamber that would suggest that there is an imminent risk around, or that there has been a collapse or there has been a structural failure that would suggest that we should have closed buildings earlier. So we need to be very cautious about our use of language around this area. Now, we're taking this issue really seriously and have been for some time. And I hope committee can be reassured about that. And we're happy to provide further evidence about how that's been taken forward, not just by government, but by others. But some of the public discourse around this has been unhelpful and may cause concern. And I think we all have a responsibility to make sure absolutely that government is being held to account and we're doing what we need to do and local authorities are and so on, but to also reassure people that if they're in a building that is identified as having rack, it is not that they are in an unsafe building, and they can be reassured that there is monitoring placed by that building owner to continually check and make sure that that remains safe. And if anything changed and the ISTRUCT guidance required either mitigation to take place or indeed a full building closure, that would happen. And indeed, it already has happened in areas. This has not came as a surprise. We've already seen some parts of the school estate where work had already been undertaken before the summer, areas of schools, for example, had been closed. And that aspect of reassurance on the situation is very, very important, as is the reassurance that we will continue to ensure that we're staying in close contact with ISTRUCT, with HSE and with other governments to ensure that if there's anything that needs to change in our approach or anything that should change, we think, on the wider public sector's approach, then we would be saying that and we would be doing that publicly.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, I think that concludes our questions, and I just want to say thanks so much for coming in and providing us with the evidence and giving us clarity on the work that the Scottish Government has been undertaking on this topic. And with that, I now briefly suspend the meeting. The next item on our agenda is consideration of two negative instruments, Local Government Pension Scheme Remedial Service Scotland Regulations 2023 and Local Government Investment Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. Do any members have any comments on the instrument? No. Does the committee agree that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? We're agreed. Thank you. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.